We'd like to do a song with juniors now.
Thank you so much for coming out here. This is definitely a first for us. At least we didn't get the frozen food section because we'd be very cold. But we're very happy to, first of all, we're just happy to be home. What always seems to happen with these books is the publishers send me on some kind of a national tour, and I have a choice to sort of go sooner or go later. Fictional Coldwater, Michigan, where one day the phones start ringing just out of the blue, and it's people calling from heaven. But it's only a handful of people, and it only happens in this one little town in Michigan and no place else on the planet. And the story follows what happens when news gets out about this town where this supposed miracle is happening, where people are calling and telling people what heaven is like. And people start descending on the town, and they start coming wanting to be part of the miracle themselves, or some of them bring their own phones, and they're holding it up to the sky, you know, they're buying the same phones as the people in the town, you know, they're all trying to get connected to people they've lost. Then the media discovers it, and it gets bigger and bigger. And meanwhile, there's this one guy in town who just recently returned. He was in prison for something he didn't do, and while he was there, his wife died, and so he wasn't even able to be with her when she died. So he's kind of brokenhearted, and he doesn't believe in anything, and he's just a kind of a bitter guy. And his seven-year-old son one day comes home with a toy phone from school and says, "When is mommy going to call us, Dad?" And he realizes that this town is just going crazy with this miracle, and he wants to set out to prove that this is false hope, that there's no such thing as a miracle, and he's going to show it. So he starts digging around for clues and digging for clues, and the story, the book kind of follows these two stories that are headed for a collision course as he digs into it deeper and deeper to the mystery, and the miracle gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and it all sort of culminates just a few days before Christmas with what's supposed to be a planned broadcast around the world from tiny Coldwater, Michigan, of the first actual phone call live from the other side, and everybody is going to listen to this, and they're finally going to be convinced that there really is a heaven, just as he seemed to have cracked the mystery of what's going on. Now, I'm going to stop there, because if I go any further, I'm going to ruin the whole book. Tad more serious. When I sat down to write this book a couple years ago, my mother, unfortunately, suffered a couple of very debilitating strokes that left her without the ability to speak. And I haven't heard my mom talk now for 3.5 years. And if you knew my mother, or if you read the book for one more day, you kind of know her. She never stopped talking when I was a kid. I was one of those kids like, when is she going to stop? But when all of a sudden the voice disappears, it's a whole different thing. And all you wish is that you could have that voice back. And I can sit with her now, I can hold her hand. I'm not sure she knows if it's me or not, but she can't speak. And I miss that voice so much. I miss the sound of that, the tenor of her voice. And I realize that when we lose people, we try so desperately to hold on to their voices, you know? We save their answering machine messages. You ever do that? Even if the message is like, there's a great sale at Kroger's, we should go tomorrow, you know, I mean, you hang on to it because it's their voice. And so it's the preciousness of the human voice and the human connection that I'm sort of writing about here. And it seems to me that we live in an age where we could have that a way more than we do. We have more phones than have ever existed in history, but we don't use them to speak. You know, we text, we email, we Instagram, we do almost anything to avoid speaking. My little nephew, who some of you have heard him on the radio over the years, you know, he grew up over in Europe. He came here when he was 18 years old, and he got hoodwinked into taking an American girl to the prom. And he'd never been to an American prom. So when he came back from the prom, I was very interested in his impression of it. I said, how was it? What did you think? He said, well, it was okay, but, you know, everybody at the table was texting. And I said, yeah, that's kind of something that it's kind of real popular in America now. Kids text their friends back home or tell them what they're doing. He said, no, they were texting each other at the table. And I hear this more and more now, where kids are literally across the room, or your kid's upstairs. upstairs and they text you down and say, hey, Mom, can you bring up a blanket? You know, this is not the way we should be communicating with one another. And I go back to something I remember my mom telling me when email came out. And I wanted to get her to go on email, even though she never used a computer. And I said, Mom, I got this great thing. It's called email. I can message you. I can send you any quick thing, anytime, day or night. You can answer whatever. And she listened to me and she said, I am never doing that.
Get up and look around. He reached for a cigarette and looked around this cheap, unfamiliar apartment. A second-story walk-up, heated by a radiator furnace. Outside the window was a cluster of pine trees and a small ravine that led to a stream. He remembered catching frogs there as a kid. Sully had returned to cold water because his parents had been taking